Okay, so hello everyone. My name is Gilad Rosen. I am the founder and the CEO of Celeno, and we are the leading provider of smart managed Wi-Fi technology. Thank you for joining this session. Over the next few minutes, I have exactly seven. I'll try to share you with our exciting growth story, and you know, if you have any follow-up questions, I'll be happy to take them afterwards. So even though we are a Wi-Fi company, I'd actually like to start by talking a little bit about psychology and about this guy, Abraham Maslow, who in 1943 invented something which is called, or developed a concept which is called the pyramid of human needs or hierarchy of human needs. It's actually quite straightforward what he's saying, that you know, the first and most important thing for human beings is physical needs, and then comes safety, and all the way till self-actualization. So, you know, this is a quite established theory, and actually some 70 years later, something happened, and the missing layer was added, that's Wi-Fi. And if you think about it, Wi-Fi is pretty much one of our physical needs nowadays. In a connected world, the one that we live at, everything is connected. We are kind of used to having and using Wi-Fi all the time, everywhere, anywhere. A couple of questions or a couple of interesting points about Wi-Fi. So first of all, as I said, seems like it has become some kind of an enabler of our modern lifestyle, always connected lifestyle. But the second thing is actually a question. Why are we always so complaining about our Wi-Fi? I guess that if I'll ask you know, anyone in the room who has a little bit of frustration around Wi-Fi, maybe I'll try it. So who's a little bit frustrated about Wi-Fi? Okay, thank you, more and more. That's my business. I think we all share the same feeling. And what I'll try to do over this presentation or over this session is A, to actually analyze what's behind this. And the second thing, to give you a little bit of color about how we, Celeno, try to address this this challenge. So a couple of interesting facts that you might have not seen or might have not been familiar with. Wi-Fi Alliance, which is the standardization body addressing Wi-Fi, predicts or estimates that by the year of 2016, by the end of last year, over 15 billion devices, Wi-Fi devices, have been shipped in the world so far. So that's an interesting point. That's a lot of Wi-Fi. The second interesting point is that by the year of 2018, the predictions or the estimations are that the number of connected devices per home will be jumping from 9 to over 25. That's a lot. And all of that is enabled by Wi-Fi. So what's wrong with Wi-Fi? And who is Celeno? So a little bit about Celeno. We are, as I said, a leading provider of smart managed Wi-Fi technology. Our business model is to develop and sell Wi-Fi chipsets and a lot of software technology in this space. We have unique technologies such as self-organizing networks, various things about interference management, about spectral management, quality of service management. I'll share with that in a minute. In terms of our investors, we are a late-stage company, we're a growth company. We have quite a few investors by now, starting with strategic, such as Aries, Liberty Global, one of the largest, if not the largest, cable company in the world, Cisco, and quite a few financial investors, such as OurCrowd, Pitango, Greylock, Red Dot, Vintage, and Prolim Capital Partners. Headquartered out of Israel with offices in the United States, China, Taiwan, Korea, and Europe. About 150 people on team, going primarily after service provider applications, cable gateways, home gateways, hotspots, IoT applications, everything that has to do with managing and supporting tens of connected devices with a well-managed quality of service profile. A little bit about our customer base. You can see here both the OEMs, and the end customers who are using our technology. As a chip and a software company, are not selling directly to, for example, Time Warner Cable, Aries, or Samsung, Technicolor, ZTE. These are the guys who are making the products with our technology inside, later on selling them to service providers such as Orange, Time Warner Cable, Sky, Deutsche Telekom, and all of those names that you can see over there. With that in mind, let's look a little bit about the challenges. And the first thing is just to give you an overview about what's happening. So we talked about the number of devices, about the number of devices per home. And this could give you a little bit of a sense about the variety of applications which are sharing the Wi-Fi resource, starting from video, data, hotspot services, 3G, 4G offload, Wi-Fi calling, Wi-Fi first, IoT. Everything is, and all of those devices are constantly and increasingly competing over the Wi-Fi resource, and that's creating a congestion. That's what we're saying is killing Wi-Fi at home. Let's look at what is it all about when people are saying Wi-Fi is lacking quality of service at home. So here, for example, we see a home, and this is the home router, and imagine yourself sitting 3 feet away from this router, watching Netflix video, and your kid is upstairs playing a very nice game. He's very distant, he's something like 30 feet away from the router, and when he starts playing, boom, you're starting getting artifacts, your screen starts buffering. The thing which happens is that this young guy upstairs is actually stealing or actually choking the entire resource, which is called the Wi-Fi router. Why? Because he's distant, and because of that, his speed is low, and because of that, when he needs to digest and accumulate and get his information, he kind of consumes the Wi-Fi resource, and your Netflix video, even though you're very close by to the router, gets stuck. Just to give you an analogy of how things happen, let's look at these. Time is up. Okay, let's look at these two videos which are not running pretty well, but we can see here cars as an analogy to data packets. And what we see here is what happens when traffic is not managed, which is what's happening with today's Wi-Fi versus managed Wi-Fi. And this is what Celeno is doing. So conventional Wi-Fi versus Celeno Wi-Fi, that's just one example. Coverage, some of you might be familiar with this example, seeking for Wi-Fi signal. What we do about that is, here is an example of some of the technologies that we've developed. We call it dynamic beam steering or beam shaping, and the router actually triangulates your location in space and directs very well focused beams exactly on your location, thus enabling a very nice signal on your device. Another nice thing that we're doing and seems to be pretty interesting for customers is creating some kind of a mini cellular network at home, Wi-Fi network at home, by putting certain extenders, as we can see here, in addition to the main router. You end up with having a smart network that hands you over between cells, handles load balancing, client steering, frequency planning, and so on. Altogether, a very, let's say, upscaled, or very strong, or very very positive user experience. Company strategy. Today, the company is focused primarily on the blue stuff, which is the core service provider business. We're now in the process of expanding into various IoT applications, industrial Wi-Fi, medical Wi-Fi, high security Wi-Fi. And maybe last thing that I'd like to do is to summarize. So who we are? We are a market leader on smart managed Wi-Fi technology. About 150 people on team. We have, we have fairly strong customer base, and we're deployed in tens of millions of homes worldwide, Asia, North America, and Europe. Company raised so far about $106 million in total from blue chip investors, and mentioned them already. We are planning to hit to cross the $100 million revenues run rate in 2018, next year. And we are planning or hoping that the split will be pretty much equal between North America, Europe, and Asia. The company is growing pretty fast. We were able to be part of the Deloitte Technology Fast 50 list three consecutive years, and altogether leveraging on the Wi-Fi issues that we've seen before. Thank you for joining the session, and any questions, I'll be happy to take them later on.
Thank you very much, Gilad. Now I'd like to welcome, please, Dudu from Invertex.
Hi. Hello, everyone. Good afternoon. My name is David Leiker, founder and CEO of Invertex. Just to focus you, we're a retail tech company, so go into the retail world. And we have a good self-explanatory movie, so I'll start with that, and that's going to explain 90%, and then I'll just compliment on that.
Shopping for shoes can be a challenge. The process can be tedious and inefficient. Shoe sizes typically vary, even within a specific brand and style. Think you're a size 8? Not necessarily. Your shoe size actually depends on the brand and style you choose. But don't give up. Welcome to the future of shoe shopping. In the store, just step onto our friendly launchpad and follow the simple instructions. Watch the 3D modeling of your feet happen in real time. And tell us who you are, so your virtual feet profile can travel with you anywhere. Now you can scan any shoe in the store, get your real-life size for that particular shoe, and more. No time to go to the shoe store? No problem. Use your phone and the Invertex app to model your feet. All you need is a regular sheet of white paper. Place the paper on the floor, put your heels against the wall, and now just follow the same easy steps using the camera of your mobile phone. 10 seconds, and you're done. So while you're at it, why not create feet profiles for the rest of your family? Have you given up on shopping for shoes online? Now with the help of your feet profile, you can enjoy online shopping with confidence that every shoe will fit perfectly. Share your profile between devices with a single swipe. Your profile will appear and guide you through the online shopping process in any device you choose. Invertex. Every story is a Cinderella story.
Okay, so we focused on the footwear world. We'll talk about the other verticals as well later on. In the footwear world, let's talk about numbers. Only 8% of shoes are bought online compared to 50% in other categories. It's lagging back very strong, and the reason it's lagging back so far is because there's a 40% return rate. So the companies that sell shoes online are constantly losing money for every shoe that they sell online, and it's a real big problem in this sector. And in general, in e-commerce, people who go onto the website and they want to order, probably most of you have tried to do that, and you get there, and at the end of the day, you're not sure if you're going to be a 12 in this shoe, or maybe it's a different brand, or going to be a 13, and you end up being in that 99% of not buying and ending up going to the store. And these companies are starting to run out of business, so Amazon is running after them, and Zappos and other companies who sell online. And Payless Shoes, for example, has just closed many stores, just read it a few days ago. And all these companies, if they don't close the gap in technology and allow you to do that, they're going to lose and go out of business. And so we sell technology to these companies, and we explain that they have a big advantage. They have stores, and if we can create the omni-channel, which is the future of shopping, everyone wants to connect the customer from the store and the home and have the same experience in both scenarios. And so we've created a portfolio of products for footwear companies. One of them is the launchpad that you saw. The other one is a mobile app. Each one of them creates a 3D model of your feet, very accurate, less than 3 millimeters away. So you're within less than a half a size error. And you can be sure and confident that when you're going to order shoes online, you're going to receive them. Of course, there's the e-commerce part where whenever you go into the e-commerce website, your avatar is going to pop up and say, hey, you're looking at that shoe, make sure to take the 12 and a half and not the 12 this time, because the 12 is not going to fit. So this is how it's done. A little bit about technology. So we're a tech company. Out of 10 people, we're a seed company. Out of 10, 8 are tech people. And we have two strong technologies. One of them is 3D scanning. So the ability to create a 3D model, like 2D pictures have been around for many years now. 3D scanning has come in very strong in the past few years, and we're able to capture the human body within less than 10 seconds in a very accurate way. And once you got this information, it's not enough to do the comparison. We actually have over 30,000 different shoes in the database, a similar amount of foot scans, And we have to use big data and machine learning to do that comparison, because otherwise it just doesn't work. So there's no mathematical equations that's going to say if this is your foot shape, this is going to be the shoe that's going to work. But there is a way that if I know that there's another 1,000 people with the exact same feet as mine in the database, and I know which shoes they bought, I can be very confident that these shoes are going to fit me as well, and this is how it works. And the numbers have been very impressive as well. So 60% of the people who walk into the store and create that avatar are going to visit the website at least once. So that's a great generator of people going to the website. And even if they don't buy, at least you're creating people who are interested in this brand's shoes who went onto the website. And industry standard is when people have their avatar and have a recommendation that they depend on, they convert 100% more. So if we're talking about 99 people not converting, it's going to go down to 98, and the numbers are huge when it comes to the revenues of this footwear company. And of course, the obvious is that there's a reduction in returns. There's not 100% reduction in returns, because fit is not the only reason for returns. Sometimes people don't like the color. Sometimes they've changed their mind. Sometimes the spouse said it's not a nice shoe, and whatever you need. So it's 50% is the numbers we've seen. And so we've reinvented the way people buy shoes, and this is implemented in stores here in Israel, in stores in the United States. Basically, just a little overview on the company. I say I have enough spare time. Footwear is one vertical, as I said, but the ability to capture the human body and compare it to the physical models of all sorts of products is a very big opportunity. And so we already have, in 2017, we're only focused on footwear because we want to be the industry standard in footwear. But later in 2018, we already have a product in eyewear that we're working on and moving down to fashion, you know, within a few years. Another small thing is just to see, I just talked about fit all the time, and I'm going to use just the 10 last seconds to say this information can be used to create a fully custom product at the end of the day. And this is where we're going to look at a place where we're going to see a model of shoe that you're going to like, and they're going to build it specifically for you. And this is where we're probably going to be in 5 years. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, David. Now I'd like to welcome Tovi from ProoV.
Good afternoon. My name is Tovi Oshinetsky. I'm the co-founder and CEO of ProoV. I like that all the previous company, including ours, came out of pain. The first one was came with Wi-Fi, second one came with shoes. I hope I fit your shoes. And actually, our company came also out of a pain, actually pain that we've been suffering for 20 years. So me and my founder have been building enterprise software startups for almost 20 years. ProoV is not our first company. And basically, for 20 years, I've been chasing CTOs and CIOs across the globe to convince them to open for me a testing environment so I can do a proof of concept so I can sell them my technology. And about 2 years ago, we said, we have to stop this. It can't be that nothing has changed for 20 years in the way how startups are approaching enterprises. And we created ProoV. Now, just before we jumped and created the company, we did a very big legwork of interviewing 170 startups and enterprises from across the globe. Actually, we used the OurCrowd network of some of that to really understand what is the shape of the pain globally, not just as Israeli entrepreneurs, but how the world see it from startups and from enterprise. We summarized this pain, how the enterprise is finding and doing the POC with the startups, into 3 points. The first point is basically how the enterprise can find the startups. Now, just think of an enterprise. You know, there's so many multinationals here on this event. I'm meeting about 100 startups only right here. How do they know which one is the right startup for them to connect? Because for an enterprise to start doing integration with each one of those startups, it makes that it takes a lot of resource out of his company, from IT departments, legal. They have to approve that he's going to open a testing environment using his own data. So there's a security issue, privacy, legal. How do you measure each one of those startups? And more than that, what do you do once you are find a startup, you start investing your time? How do you know what will happen once you are moving from the testing environment to the production environment? So this is what we created ProoV. Just to give you a flavor of the number, exactly last year and this summit, we launched our beta. Since launching our beta, we have more than 100 enterprises from Fortune 100 that is on the platform. We already finished 153 POCs on the platform, so although we are startups, but we are one of the biggest POC vendor that runs so many cycles, and we have hundreds of startups on the platform. And the way that we are solving this pain, this is the reason that we are getting these embracements from the ecosystem, especially from the enterprise. And again, I was overwhelmed by how enterprises are approaching us. And again, we are a small company and we are getting, so our marketing is almost very easy because we are getting the inbound emails from enterprises that want to onboard the platform because of the pain that we are solving them. Because the first thing that we are doing for them, we are providing them a sophisticated marketplace that they can scout for the right startup. Every startup that is on the marketplace has already been approved by ProoV. We have a team of analysts that check each startup technology-wise and financially-wise. Then, once he finds the startup and he starts doing the connection with the startup, he can have a real-time KPI measurements of few startups that are connected in real-time. And this is a very key thing for the enterprise, because an enterprise, until ProoV, have been working in a CRM mode. So let's say an enterprise wants to open a few POCs. So first of all, he opens a P after he goes all the struggle of legal, privacy, etc. He opens a POC in cybersecurity. Then he needs to find the right startup. Then he finishes this cycle, but he wants to compare another startup, so he has to do another integration with another startup. How do you compare the startup to startup? With ProoV, we give them a real-time KPI comparison, how each one of those startups are behaving, and an apple-to-apple comparison. And more than that, on the dashboard, we give them a prediction analytics tools, which is basically like the crystal ball for the technology. Because not only we are telling him how this startup has behaved on a testing environment, we are also giving him a simulation tool that will tell him what's happening once you're moving this startup from a testing environment to a production environment. The way that it works for the enterprise is very similar. The enterprise is onboarding our platform. There's a very easy wizard that takes them to the entire process, how you open the POC on the platform. And by the way, when you open a POC on the platform, it goes from a very sophisticated either Linux-based, Windows-based with RX connection, on cloud-based, or on-prem testing environment, all the way how do you upload the testing data or the POC testing data. You upload your own legal, so we are taking care of how we are signing up your legal for you. Then you are running those POC, and you can see how each one of those startups are behaving. And I just want to show you two case studies, one that was just finished yesterday night, which is a very interesting story. Twin City Fan is one of the largest manufacturers in the US for industrial fan sealing. And they had a problem. Their fan was whistling. They had a problem in the design. They couldn't solve this problem. And when the fan was circulating, it was doing a very bad whistle. So they came to our platform. They upload the data of that whistle that they couldn't solve. And after 24 hours, a startup from the Netherlands by the name of Sinoscope has actually found this problem and actually found a solution for that. And after two more days that they ran other startups compared to that, they found the best solution out of these different startups. And they just 2 days ago signed a contract with one of those startups. Now, this is an enterprise in the US closing deals with Europe startups. Nobody was flying. There was no waste of time. Immediately, once they uploaded the problem to the testing environment, they found the solution. Another very interesting story is happened here in Israel. ISROCARD is the largest credit card provider in Israel, which is a very enterprise, financial enterprise that's trying to disrupt this ecosystem. But because of the Ministry of Finance, the Israeli trust regulation, and different regulation that every financial institution is running under, there is a problem how a financial institution can check innovation because of the privacy and the legal issue. So they start working with ProoV. They started with one POC. Gradually, they opened 12 POCs with 32 startups that were connected on that POCs. And they finished this cycles of POC a few weeks ago, and they signed contract with the 6 startups. Now, Ron, the CEO of ISROCARD, starts becoming our best ambassador, and he starts speaking on behalf of ProoV in leading conferences because we solve him 3 years of pain that he finished in 3 months. Now, this is a huge benefit from the enterprise that you can start check for innovation in a parallel mode checking multiple POCs with multiple vendors, each one of those POCs, finding the real solution for you, and close contract with them. Thank you very much. We have a booth here on the show. We're more than happy to answer your questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Toby. Now I'd like to welcome, please, Sari from Elastic Media. Ronan from Elastic Media.
Hi, my name is Ronan, and I'm the CEO of Elastic Media. Let's start with some history. In 1439, Johann Gutenberg invented the printing machine and actually created what we know today as mass communication. In the end of the 19th century, Tesla invented, he was creating the first radio, and he expanded our sense of hearing. We could sit here in Jerusalem and hear what was happening on the other side of the world.
The United States, yes, the resolution of the Duck Committee for Palestine was adopted by 33 votes, 13 against, 10 abstentions.
So that's amazing. We were sitting here in Jerusalem and we could actually hear what was happening on the other side of the world. But when Ludi Berge invented TV in 24, okay, something's not working. Okay, somebody help me. How come Bill Gates gets all his money? So TV actually expanded the way that we can see things. We can sit here in Jerusalem and see that the landing on the moon. And today we can change something much more interesting. When you combine the sense of hearing, the sense of sight, and the touch, we can change cognition. And that's interesting because the best application like Siri, like Facebook, like Waze, actually change the way that we think, behave, and react. And let's talk about where we fit into the pictures. So visual storytelling began in the cinema, when you had a large audience, a large screen, and 2 hours of entertainment. Next came TV, as we said, which was a family experience, which was the art of technology had to change. The shows became shorter, you had ad breaks, and the techniques like laugh track had to be invented in order to make sure that, to address the problem that we are now a viewer and not an audience. And today, the art of technology, of digital storytelling, have to change again. And this is where we are now, where we need to understand that the viewer is lean is not a lean back experience, but it's a lean forward experience. And the screens follow you everywhere. The you is the individual, and the screen follow you in the bus, to the toilet, and even some of you right now looking at the screen, right? So content need to adapt to this new reality where you have less time, it's less amount of less patient, and the viewer is individual. And that's creating a huge business model problem. Because the problem is that traditional viewing and monetization models are becoming irrelevant. Why? Basically, it took more than 10 years to learn how to tell a story from the TV to, from the movies to the TV. And now we have a second revolution, and we think we need to create a new way of telling a story on mobile. So let me show you what we do. Hope Bill Gates will help me.
Welcome to the world of Elastic Media.
Now, New York's number one news, Channel 7, Eyewitness.
Where we put the viewer in the driver's seat.
We're going to have much more on the side of the explosion in just a minute. But when it begins...
Using intuitive swipe and touch controls, viewers can navigate through entire shows, quickly locating the clips they want to see.
News for an American Airlines flight had to be diverted.
When they find a clip that looks interesting, they can watch the complete headline.
Syracuse.
Rain is beginning to lighten up, but the danger is not far from over in South Carolina. One day after the state's capital's wettest day...
If they like the headline and want to see more, they just touch the icon to watch the entire segment. They can also swipe to the next or previous segment anytime. Elastic Media's end-to-end platform gives users the power to create their own personalized video experience, placing control of what they see, how much they see, and how quickly they discover it right in the palm of their hand. Our exclusive cognitive system also learns from users' curiosity to customize the order, context, and type of content presented. Elastic Media, mastering the art and technology of digital storytelling.
So let me go really quick about our value proposition. For the users, we have a lean forward engagement experience, more content to choose from, and the real-time personalization. And basically, we put the last mile of editing in the hand of the users. For content owner, we create for them more revenues, more video views, and unique data. Today, one editor have to choose what would be the length of a video. We'd let this power to the end user. But the heart of what we are doing is the Elastic Cognitive Network. So if you remember one thing about Elastic Media, let it be this site. So let me put it this way. Our cognitive network is creating a unique user engagement into what we call a personalized vector, a new level of end-to-end personalization. In a different way, like Google learned from search, we learned from video, okay? So this is where we are standing right now. We have two live pilots with Channel 2, and KSET was just launched this week to the public, so you can go to KSET site, it's TV of California. We invest a lot in protecting our unique technology, and we have a significant portfolio, and we have completed the seed round, and we have a very great team that is working. I'm proud of our team, which is based right here in the Hebrew University in Jerusalem, and I want to thank you and invite all of you to feel and experience it in our booth here at the OurCrowd event. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Lonen. Now I'd like to welcome Mark from Nanorep.
So it's very nice automatically. Yeah. Hello, my name is Mark from Nanorep. And the question is, are you ready? Are you ready, according to this statement of Gartner, that by 2020, 85% of customer relationships with enterprises will be conducted without any human interaction? So this is just around the corner in 3 years from now, and this has a large impact on businesses in the way that they conduct their relationship with their customers. So if till today this is the experience that you as the customers find in the market, if you have an issue with a business, usually you pick up the phone, call the call center, wait on the line, hope to get the answer. In terms of technology, the business is being supporting the agent in terms of ticketing system, chat system, and even self-service solutions. But at the end of the day, the agent is the first channel which you interact with. So what we see these days is that this pyramid flips, and what the businesses are looking to do is, first of all, to provide you an automated support. And this goes along also with how the customers are looking to consume and to basically get the support. And this is, again, basically because of the age of the millennials, these young generations that feel very comfortable today to support themselves, and they're really not looking to call a call center, wait on the line with the agent, and to solve their problems through someone else. So this is how the future is looking to be. And there are some principles that need to be part of such a solution in order to really to provide a very good experience to the users. So this is us. This is what we provide. We basically provide a holistic solution of a self-service journey for the customers. In order to provide this solution, the main capabilities that should be supported, and of course we support, first of all, we should be able to understand the intent of the user. So it's not a secret that people will interact differently, rephrase differently their questions when they interact through a self-service channel. And the trick of our system, basically this is based on our NLP and AI technology, is the ability to understand the intent. It could be, by the way, in 84 languages. And by understanding the intent, to provide the exact and unique answer that the customer is looking for. So as an example, if you use Nanorep on El Al Airlines, which is one of our customers, and you'll ask how many suitcases can I bring to the plane, or if you ask what is my baggage allowance, which are two different questions, and there are no similar keywords in these two questions, basically Nanorep will understand the intent and provide the same answer. Another thing that should be supported is the ability to provide contextual answers, meaning two customers may ask the same question, but they're looking for two different answers. As an example, Vodafone is one of our customers, and if you go to Vodafone and ask how to turn on my GPS, the system, Nanorep, would not provide you 200 answers, such as Google, which probably one of them will fit your need. Rather than that, it will ask you or identify what device do you have and will provide you the specific answer related to you as an individual customer. If you use us through one of the banks, which are also beyond our customers, and you'll ask what is my bank balance, it won't provide an answer. If you have several accounts, it will ask you to which account do you refer to, and so on. The third capability, which is very important, is the ability to guide the user through completing a process. Sometimes just explaining what to do is not good enough, and you would like to guide the user field by field through the process until completion. So we also support a capability of guidance on the website, on the mobile app, or on any different channel that the user is using. This capability of channeling is a very important topic. At the end of the day, the idea of the business, the objective of the business, is that once a customer decides to use a self-service channel, you would like to make sure that he's satisfied and he doesn't churn from the channel because he's not getting the right experience. So if for certain reasons Nanorep is not able to provide the best answer to the user, we would like as a business to provide the ability for the user to escalate to a different channel. What we can do by understanding the intent behind the question, we can differentiate between high-value questions and low-value questions, and if the question is in high-value profile, we can decide to escalate it to a chat with an agent or to the call center itself. If it's a low-value question, we can decide just to provide the customer the ability to fill in a form or an email. So by that, first of all, we deflect a lot of calls from the call center, save a lot of money to the business, and we focus the agents only on the high-value questions and not on the simple questions that the customer can get answers through different channels. It's important to add that today you don't know how customers are interacting with you. It could be through many different channels, like the mobile app, like the desktop, maybe on Facebook, on a chat bot on Facebook. And the idea is to provide the same technology through all touch points, and this is actually what we do. We have around 500 customers, and each customer deploys our solution in different ways according to their strategy. This slide is very important, sorry. this slide shows us basically the reflection of the voices of the customer in the back end of the solution. The idea here is that regardless the touch point that the customer is using, we as a business will know all the time what is the experience of the user, and we should have the ability to fix the experience if we find that it's not good enough. By the way, it's the red tile, which basically represents the bad experience in compared to the blue tile, which is the best experience. I'm hearing the bell. I'll just move on and say that we have great KPIs. The implementation is very fast. These are just three examples. To implement us, it can take between 6 to 8 weeks. This is a list of our customers. Our main verticals are retail, travel, finance, and telco. And if someone is interested with our solution, we have a booth here, and I'll be very happy to demo our solution. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Mark. Now I'd like to welcome Gil from Missbeez.
Hi everyone. I apologize, I'm not going to speak about enterprise software, but I am going to show a lot of nice pictures. So it's pretty obvious that within a few years from now, maybe even less, we're going to click a button and a drone will fly over and deliver our deliveries. It's also pretty obvious that within a few years from now, we're going to click a button when we land somewhere, and instead of an Uber driver, we're just going to get a car. We are living in an on-demand era, and still, for some things in life, we still need to pick up the phone in advance, call and book for an appointment a few days ahead, drive all the way, look for parking slots, and then wait in line, even though we have an appointment, just to get something like a haircut. It's weird that even today, in 2017, we still need to ask people's recommendation on Facebook or Google just to get a decent massage. Now, we are Missbeez, and we are here to change it. We are here to reinvent the way busy people like ourselves consume lifestyle services. Tell him I said hi. Who are we? Maya Gura, my partner and the CEO of the company. She's a serial entrepreneur. This is her third company. Both of her previous companies were acquired successfully by Getty Images and eBay. And myself, I have over 16 years of experience doing mostly enterprise software sold worldwide. Together with us, we have a really great team of advisors with Yori from OurCrowd First, you probably know him, Verit from Fiverr, Gigi Levy from NFX, and other experts who are helping us. And together with our amazing team, we've built Missbeez. Missbeez is a marketplace for lifestyle services on demand. Now, let's talk a little bit about lifestyle services. There are many verticals when we talk about lifestyle. For example, beauty, wellness, fitness, and others. In each vertical, you can find really tens of different services. But when you look closely in all of those services, you find that all of them are done by professionals. They require a face-to-face meeting. And even though they usually take place in a spa or a salon, they can actually take place in our home. We started with beauty. Beauty alone stands for $400 billion worldwide, and this is just for nails and hair, with an average transaction of $50 every month. This is what women usually spend on beauty. So if, we've figured out that this is a niche market, but pretty nice, a good niche to start with. And we've created this beautiful app that allows our customers to click a button and get someone who will come to do nails, hair, and all sorts of other beauty services. So it's comfortable, someone comes over, it's hassle-free, a few clicks away and you get the service. It's working 24/7, perfect for busy people, and it's a branded solution. All of the service providers are going through a serious process that we do in order to make sure that they are the best. For the service providers, there are some amazing added values. It's a we give them actually an unlimited access to customers. They can actually pick the one they want to serve. We help them double or even triple their salary. And They get to work in a flexible hours. They choose when they want to work. We are talking about a sophisticated marketplace. We call it a sophisticated marketplace because unlike transportation, for example, which is one generic service, here we are dealing with multiple services, and the optimization needs to take into account skills, materials, equipment. Of course, we need to get on time based on the location and travel, and we are talking about phased professional, which means actually that I want to know who is coming to do my massage. I'm going to be half naked. He's going to come to my house. I want to know who is that is. Just to give you a clue, there aren't too many platforms and marketplaces out there who are dealing both with phased services and multiple services. In addition, when talking about beauty, which is the market that we started with, this is an intimate service. So we had to deliver amazing capabilities to kind of create a natural experience. Our customers can see all of our best professionals before they make an order. While making an order, we don't just match someone. We give them the option to select out of a variety of options. We give them the ability to chat with the service provider before and after the service. And if they like him or her, they can mark them as their favorite so that next time they can just call them directly through the platform. We started a pilot in Tel Aviv a year ago. And to be honest, the results so far are remarkable. Let me just share with you some of the numbers. 30,000 customers, 270 professionals already registered in our system. We started with one city, and today we are operating in over 40 cities and areas in Israel. We've delivered 18,000 services so far, and according to rumors, we didn't count it, we've colored 150,000 nails so far. And what more important is that we've got over 5,000 positive reviews. This means that customers absolutely love Missbeez. Some other KPIs. With 15% conversion rate in all of the country, we have over 30% conversion rate from downloads to payers. I don't know if you are familiar with numbers, similar numbers, but this is a unique number. In addition, 50% retention rate after a year. This is a crazy retention rate. That means that we barely have a churn on a monthly average after the first few months where we see the main drop. And that leads into a very high net LTV, which is over $100. So with those kind of numbers, we believe that we have an amazing product market fit. And with that in mind, we've continued to enhance and improve our technology, because after all, we are a technology company. Beyond just the mobile application, we have a powerful backend system that lets us control everything that is happening in the field, both from desktop and from mobile. We've created a very good marketing machine that combines both external services like email, push, and the likes with internal capabilities like segmentation tools, in-app promotion. This is important for us in order to practically control the level of the demand on an hourly basis. And if that's not enough, all of our architecture is fully scalable. We are using multi-tenant, it's multilingual from day one, and we made it ready for our expansion. We would like to expand in Europe and to major cities like London, Barcelona. And in fact, we've already started working in Barcelona. A few months ago, we've pre-launched London. And we now have something like 10,000 customers there with over 100 registered service providers. So with that in mind, we are sure that we can conquer London, if you will. And we are ready to the official launch, which will take place in a few weeks from now. And hopefully we manage to provide similar numbers to what we did in Tel Aviv, and even better. So thank you all for listening, and hopefully you'll be joining us to this amazing journey of Missbeez. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Gal. That was our final presentation for this session. If you're interested in investing or hearing more information about any of the companies you heard about, please feel free to approach me, and I'll put you in touch with one of our investor relations representatives. I thank you very much for attending. Enjoy your lunch and the rest of your time here at the Global Summit.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for joining us. My name is Ariella, and I'm part of the OurCrowd business development team. I'd like to take this opportunity to personally welcome you to OurCrowd's Global Investor Summit. At this session, you'll have the opportunity to hear from some of our marketplace portfolio companies, and we hope that you'll enjoy them as much as we do. So without further ado, I'd like to welcome Lior from Splacer.
Hi, everyone. Hi, everyone. Thank you for joining. It's a pleasure to be here. I'm going to tell you a little bit about Splacer, what we do. Okay, so Splacer is a platform for space owners to grow their business. It's not for spaces that host events, usually. It's for everyone. So if you have a nice apartment and it's empty half of the day when you're at work, you can rent it for an event. So people can come in and do a meetup or a summary, or they can do a baby shower at your place, and you can go back at the evening after cleaning your space, and it's yours. So why is it going so fast? Okay, I'll do it here. Just a minute. Sorry, 1 minute, please. Okay. So, in this example for a minute, a space can do additional 150K revenue a year just by renting the space when it's empty for events. This is an art gallery. At the evening, they're showing exhibitions and so on, but at the morning, they can host a brainstorm, they can host a product launch, they can do many other types of events and earn additional money. So what do space owners need? They need, of course, they want to do more money. So they need the demand. They need leads and they need business. But also they need tools to manage that business efficiently. So this is basically what Spacer gives them. What do? We give them a marketplace where people can come in, they can list their space, and they can, and then on the marketplace, people can find the space based on their attributes and actually close a deal through the marketplace. But we also give them management tools where they can actually manage all their business, all their events, even if they bring leads from other platforms, and thus have one place where they can handle their calendar and meetings and even invoicing and payments through our platform. So it's not only for Splacer platform, but also for all their leads and all their business. Sorry for, so how do we, let's go back and talk a little bit, how do we bring demand? So we talked a little bit about the marketplace. Marketplace is just one way to bring demand to businesses. But another way which is really interesting regarding our market is referrals. So if you're a space and you close 4 or 5 events a month, you need to have 20 leads. So it means that from the 20 leads, 15 you're going to say no to. Those 50 leads, those 50 people that are trying to do your their events in the space will just go out of the door and then you lose them. What we are giving the space owner is the ability to refer those people back into the marketplace. So they won't lose the demand. They give them a better service, they give those people a better service, and B, they can earn money by sharing the booking with us. And plan, just remember that, services, I'm going to talk about it in a minute. As we've said, efficiency. So in order to give efficiency to space owners, we give them management tools to let them be organized instead of actually writing everything down and managing things through email and calendar. They have one place where they see all their leads, all the pipeline of business, they can see their calendar, they can send invoice and track, they can do all the messaging around closing an event in one place. And this is our platform for their efficiency. A little bit about our numbers. So we've grown since 2015 to 2016, we've grown in 1,000%. We're already operating in four cities. It's New York, San Francisco, LA, and Miami. We are planning to open additional two cities in the next 2 months. We already have 1,100 spaces, and we are able to recruit those spaces using marketing efforts, not sales efforts, which is unique. We have thousands of inquiries a month in our marketplace, and over 40,000 people have already been hosted on Splacer events. Okay. Just a little bit about the market size. The addressable event market size is $90 billion. $30 billion is the space, and $60 billion is the services. That's only in the US a year. How do we do our money? We cut a commission from space owners, 15%. We cut 5% commission, 5% transaction fees from the event organizers. And we, on the referrals, we'll cut 7.5% because we share our profit with the space that send us the referral. A little bit about the services I told you about before. So on top of the closing the events, we can help spaces give additional services. We can give them, of course, content like food and drink and music. We can also give them cleaning and insurance and photography services, which are all operational services. And we can give them digital services like invitation systems, marketing services, data and reports. So all these are potential values for increasing our market and revenues. Oops, this is, if you want to see this slide, you need to come to me later on. A little bit about what we plan. That's the numbers for the next 3 years. I'm almost out of time, so I'm here with Lihi. Spacer was founded by Lihi and Adi originally, and I've joined them about 2 years ago, and since then we're here. Lihi and Adi are architects, and space is something they know about. Thank you. Last note. About an event that we had in Splacer, I think it's the funniest one. We had a gallery in Chelsea. A guy went there and really liked the artwork and decided that he's going to propose his girlfriend there. They made an event for $5,000. Four people have been in this event, of course, him and the girl, and two photographers just in case. And guess what?
She said yes.
So who thinks that she said yes? We're all very pessimistic. She said yes. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Lior. Now please welcome Greg from Zoomcar.
Thanks so much, guys, for being here. So I presented earlier today, so you may have a vague idea about the business. So Zoomcar, we're India's first and largest car rental company. So we like to say so self-drive car rental in India. That's a bit of a misnomer as you think about it in the context of Israel or Europe or the US, because we actually don't do anything related to autonomous driving. It just means that you're actually renting a car and driving yourself without a chauffeur. So we've been at it now for actually about 4 years. So we're just now coming up on the four-year anniversary as a company. We have a fleet of nearly 3,000 cars. We're across 17 markets. So we're doing about 2,000 rides a day. And that's growing, ever expanding on a month-on-month basis. The way the business sort of started off as we were evolving, we always found a very, very robust demand. And so it's something that we've actually had world-leading utilization rates where we've been close to 70% occupancy over the last 4 years on average. If you look at the global average, it's around 55% or so. And so as a result of that, we've really had to focus a lot on keeping our supply up to the mark and building supply very, very quickly. And so that's why we're here kind of speaking today, because we're evolving our model so that we can take in cars in a much more robust way through a marketplace platform. We have individuals now who can actually buy cars and attach them to Zoomcar, which I'll get into a little bit more as we go ahead. So our business at its core in India, it's about creating an amazing customer experience, really from soup to nuts. So looking from the booking process, which you can see some of the highlights here, in terms of very clean, elegant UI that's driven both on the website as well as the app. We do about 90% of our bookings on the app. So India, it's a unique market where we kind of leapfrog from computers, where people didn't even have desktops, laptops. They went straight to smartphones that are $50, $50 Android phones, which are now permeating across the country. And that's going to become even more robust in the coming months, coming years. And that's what enables us. So everything we do is built for mobile and built for really amazing experiences where you strip out the unnecessary human interventions and actually create a very seamless experience, which is all digitized. And that's what the Indian consumer really, really values. So for us now, over the last 6 to 9 months, we've been really focused on this platform here, which is Zap. So this is our marketplace, this is our P2P program, which allows individuals to buy cars and then fractionally share them with Zoomcar. So a little bit like an Airbnb type for cars, but the difference is that people are actually going out procuring the new cars. Part of this is due to a regulatory constraint, but what we found is that in India, on average, people use a car about 10% of the time. And this is a way to tap into that low utilization, and you can offset the monthly fixed cost of car ownership by about 75 to 80%. You find that most people are listing on the platform for 20 days or so out of the month. So it's a great collaboration, and this is something which we expect to scale and grow to about 80% of our fleet by the end of this year. We're at 3,000 cars today. We're taking that total number to around 10,000 by the end of the year. So we're looking at this as being at least 7,000 to 8,000 in total strength by the end of this calendar year. And so how are we going to do it? I mean, for us, one of the big challenges when you think about a marketplace is making sure that there's this security element where people feel comfortable contributing their asset as such to the platform. And that's where I was talking earlier today about the IOMT, the notion of Internet of Moving Things. And so this is a moniker that we have internal to us. But it really allows us to think deeply about the customer experience when you're out driving and to make sure you have real-time analytics and data around the performance of the car, the health and wellness, avoiding accidents, avoiding breakdown, making sure then that the customer is bringing the car back in the right condition for that associate owner who's sharing that car. So that builds a two-sided trust, and that's what we've developed through this hardware/software solution. You have a device in the car, taps and leverages the OBD. It allows you to do keyless entry in and out of the car, GPS tracking 24/7, a lot of automations built in, as well as immobilization technology. And so that keeps the security at the highest of levels. And for us, it goes even more further because it's about leveraging the data that we have, where we have over 150 million kilometers driven since inception, and that allows us to mine data in such a way that we can leverage what is going in from this device, from our platform called Kadabra, to give new real-time alerts around such as clutch, brake, engine, suspension, so all of these elements that you see here. And so this is really, really core to what we have as a business. And this is going to unlock way, way more opportunities for us to bring in more and more people onto the platform. So, this is the wrong presentation that was. There's two. No. So there's another deck that was sent. It's fine. No worries. Instead of showing the movie here, just to show you for us, as we move ahead here in the next 6 months, so one of the big pushes for us over and above what we have as our core business opportunity, which is around scaling Zap in India, we're also looking out very, very aggressively to other markets. So we're targeting Southeast Asia as a great opportunity as we go out, because what we found is that the infrastructural realities that exist in India and the consumer psychology preferences that are there in India very much exist in markets like in Indonesia, markets exist in, say, in Nigeria, in a Kenya, et cetera. And so this is what we want to do, because it's very, very rare that you've had a company in India building sort of a B2C platform with a core technology stack that will then apply that same principle, the same discipline to other markets. So looking at Southeast Asia, looking at Africa, That's very sort of unique as a model. But we think because of the realities that exist in India and because of our technology solution that we have, that puts us in a very, very strong position. So, you know, till date, our largest investors are Sequoia, and they led our Series A and participated also in our Series B, and then Ford Motor Company, so they led our Series B investment just most recently. We also have, of course, the team in OurCrowd has contributed over the course of two rounds now, and then also Nokia Growth Partners, and so they're connected car fund, and so we've had, you know, a really strong coterie of investors who have enabled us to kind of get to where we are today, and you know, we're quite confident we'll help springboard us into the, you know, the next 2-3 years as we move abroad and go beyond. So, and thanks.
Thanks very much, Greg. Now I'd like to welcome Eitan from Freightos.
Do we need, can you guys hear me in the back if I speak without a mic?
Yes.
Yes, okay. Is it okay? I need, raise your hand if you don't want me to not use a mic.
Wonderful.
Okay. My name is Eitan Buckman, and I run marketing at Freightos, and there's nothing more that you probably want at 4 p.m. on a long day than to hear about international freight. It's obviously just as sexy as a Zoom car, right? So I tell myself at least. I want you guys to look down at your feet. Look at your shoes, look at your pants, look at your shirt, look at the computers. Every single thing in this room came from somewhere, right? We don't think about it. I didn't grow up wanting to get into freight technology. But when you look around, every single thing is shipped. 90% of what we use is shipped in huge ocean liners. Everything else comes by air and truck. It is the world's second largest industry, $19 trillion worth of goods are shipped around the world every single year. So, an industry like that must be amazing, right? Well, no. If you call up a freight forwarder is essentially a travel agent for international freight. If you call them up and you say, hey, I need to ship something from China to the United States, it will take them an average of 90 hours. I checked, I did this from the top 20 freight forwarders in the world, 90 hours to get a freight quote. And it sucks for them because it's manual. They're using spreadsheets, they're using calculators, maybe typewriters, I don't know. It's taken them a really, really long time, and a result of that manual effort is that there's a 30% price spread across prices. You call up one freight forwarder, you'll get one price. Call another one, you'll get a different price. And I know this because our CEO started with a problem. Every good startup starts with an issue, right? Our CEO, who has sold companies to IBM and GE, had a company that was regularly importing goods on the world's largest trade lane, China to the United States. And every single time he tried to ship his electronics along that trade lane, it took way too long. So when he sold his last company, he decided, okay, let's fix this issue. Which is why he started Freightos. Freightos is trying to make global trade frictionless, which sounds really, really cool, by creating the Expedia of international freight. And it's really, really hard. If you think about airlines, Expedia, airlines have been automated since 1958, there should be, there's missing an S there. 1958 was when two guys named Smith, one from American Airlines and one from IBM, sat next to each other on an airplane and said, hey, we could build a computer that helps airlines automate their sales. So before the internet, before Amazon, before eBay, before Google, airlines were online and travel agents were able to tap into that. So when you think of Expedia, any marketplace, right, these are all marketplaces that are presenting, any marketplace has a sell side and a buy side. Right, Expedia, sell side airlines, buy side us. When it comes to international freight, whether it's ocean or air, even though it's the same airplane, and you're on that airplane, the seats are automated, they've been automated since 1958, the cargo on those airplanes are still unautomated. So it's manual and everything's really, really slow. So when we decided to create the Expedia for international freight, we had a really big task. The first task was to bring freight companies online. So what we did is, before starting our marketplace, we built a SaaS application that we sold to freight companies to use internally. In less than 5 years, 90% of the world's top logistics providers are now using Freightos technology in-house to automatically generate freight quotes. That means that if you wanted to ship something, if you're a company and you call up Siva Logistics, or Nippon Express, or Panalpina, huge global logistics providers that we don't know because no one really thinks about freight, these huge companies, when you call them up, the sales guy that's on the other side of the phone is using Freightos technology to get you freight quotes. So we made a tremendous amount of progress, right? The graph over there is the number of freight quotes that we have automated through Freightos, and it's growing faster and faster. But that was only one side. That was the sell side, which is why it was really, really interesting. Last year in June, in June we soft launched our marketplace. July we actually launched our freight marketplace, and it's taken off like crazy. What we did was we created this marketplace where any company, whether it's a retail company, a textile company, can log online to ship.freightos.com and instantly compare air, ocean, and trucking rates from the world's top freight forwarders. Now, for us, or for people that aren't in the freight world, you look at it and you say, wow, this isn't such a big deal, but this is huge. Because companies like Cisco Foods or Marks and Spencer's, global giants, get their supply chains held up because it takes a long time to get freight quotes. So what we do is you go online to ship.freightos, you enter exactly what you want to ship. Right now, we're not rolled out globally yet, but on the right routes, you will get instant door-to-door freight quotes, whether it's air, ocean, and trucking, on which freight forwarders to use in order to ship your goods. But it doesn't end at just finding the right price quote, because when it comes to Expedia, we book our tickets online, and then we get ourselves to the airport, we make sure that we're on the airplane, when they cancel our flight or bump us onto the next flight, we make sure that we find the right hotel to stay at. People take care of themselves. Freight doesn't. So you need to know what happens with your shipment regularly. If any of you have ever imported a Lyft to Israel, you know that, as we say, shit happens, right? Things go wrong. And so it comes down to transportation management as well. You can't just let somebody book a freight quote online. You have to provide impeccable support. Sorry, I've been pitching all day. You have to provide incredible support. So we also provide the ability to manage your shipments online. And then last and most important thing is, if you're a company and you're shipping $200,000 worth of goods, you don't really care if you're saving $10 on your shipment, right? These are big shipments. So what we need to do is we need to make sure that we differentiate on service as well, which is why we provide 24/7 support around the clock, wherever you're shipping. And we do that to both freight forwarders to keep them happy and to our marketplace consumers. Freightos has created a world-class team. Right now, C. Schreiber's our CEO. He has experience from selling companies, as I said, IBM and GE. We have executives that come from the freight world, like D.B. Schenker, executives that come from HP, people with experience at Amazon. Our CTO was a former 3PL logistics technology guy at Amazon. And over the past 5 years, we built a huge company. We've raised about $32 million in funding. We have a team of 145 people around the world. And if you've been around the block, you know that's a really big team for a startup. We basically created two separate products. We've created a SaaS platform that freight companies are using in-house and a marketplace, and we're scaling really, really, really quickly. We're getting a lot of love from the media, but what's much more interesting for us is that we're getting a lot of people booking online. I probably could have just stopped at this chart right over here. This is just the past 6 months alone. The graph that you're seeing on the left is the number of orders per month, and every once in a while, these are huge. Average order size is somewhere between $3,000 and $4,000. Every once in a while, we'll get somebody that will just, I woke up this morning, $20,000 shipment. So it's taking off really, really quickly. The best way that everybody in our crowd can help is to recommend us to people that you know. If you know somebody that imports goods, that exports goods, sells things, tell them to check out freightos.com. Thank you.
Quick question. Yeah. Anything else going for consumers at some point?
No. Not for the foreseeable future.
Thanks very much, Eitan. Now I'd like to welcome Ran from EquityX.
Hello, everybody. So co-founding EquityX, I co-founded five companies, and based on the experience of these five companies, we decided to co-found EquityX to solve some of the pain points that failed during this 25 years of building five companies. First one was OptiBase, that actually IPO in NASDAQ, and Vicon IPO in France. Pitch Networks was sold to Microsoft after 2 years of inception. My biggest exit was Big Ben Networks, that we were in IPO in NASDAQ in 2007. And then Watchit, that so far raised $28 million and still private and growing. And then I decided to build EquityX, which is the only company so far that is not using a deep technology. But EquityX was founded to solve one of the biggest pain points that I have during this building this company, which is the problem that every one of them was a big, big roller coaster. Almost several times, we had to shut down the company to lack of cash. Even in Big Band, after we did the first round of $30 million, after almost 3.5 years, we almost ran out of cash. I had to lay off about 50% of the company, and then basically was able to do another round, then take the company public. And the main issues that back then is a lack of cash is every startups have a lot of goals to achieve before being able to basically do the next round. Cash is very scarce. The KPIs that are needed to make the next round is really high. It's getting higher all the time. And one of the tools that actually could help companies solve their cash flow problem is using their equity compensation to be able to do more before the next round. And this is exactly what we do here in EquityX. Before we talk what are we doing, let's talk about the problem today that with the equity compensation. So first, the big issue is finding the right expert. Not only finding the right experts that can help the startup to achieve their goals, if it's product development, if it's business development, marketing, it's finding the right experts that are willing to work for equity. Not every expert can willing to actually work for equity. Then the other issue is quantification. Let's say you find somebody that they're willing to do this task for you, let's say some business development in Asia. You need them to do A, B, C, D, and it's the US dollar equivalent for this task is about $10,000. How much equity are you going to give them? Something based on the last round, using fair market value. It's a big problem to quantify a task that you can actually quantify in US dollar equivalent in equity. Then one of the problems that today with every allocation, no matter if it's a development of a UX for $5,000 or a big, you need to go through board approval, a lot of legal work and contracts, and there's big tax issues. If you don't do it right, some of the experts will need to be taxed when they get the future equity much, much before the company get to an exit. And even if you do it right, in some cases when the expert and the startup are not in the same country, there's gonna be some tax issues. And all of these things that we basically solved in EquityX platform. So the bottom line for me is that I was able, in all my five companies over the last 5 years, I was able to use equity, but not for people that are actually doing real work for me. Mainly for top advisors that actually, you know, you give them like a 0.25%, you need them for the credibility on the website. But I was not able to use it for more than that just because it was complicated. So what is EquityX? We launched a service 3 months ago when we actually got OurCrowd to invest because it's very synergetic to OurCrowd. But EquityX is basically the first marketplace. So on one side we have top tier startups, and on the other side a lot of experts that are very good in what they do, that can help startups, and they're willing to work for equity. And the main value proposition that we have is to be able them to find each other. We are very strong, we have unique algorithms and a strong customer success team that enable to find each other, and then to collaborate and use equity to use as a currency. What the resource you can find in EquityX, basically anybody, starting from all the way from advisor and mentorship, but things that people that can help you with biz dev and marketing all over the world, all the way to product development, UX, growth hackers, anybody that is acing in this field worldwide can actually be here. And again, we have the tools to bring them on based on the need of real startups, and this is something that we do very well. How it works. So to make it easy, the way we actually build it is very similar to a convertible loan. So a startup can actually come today to log in and join the platform. And the only things the board need to approve at this level is like a pool, let's say a 250,000 pool that the startup, the CEO can actually use over time with EquityX. One time board approval, they don't need to get approval for every single allocation for every different expert. Startup go in and basically start to put what we call it beats. So basically anything that they need help in, either in product development, biz dev, marketing, UX, whatever they need to. And we actually use very smart algorithms and customer success team to help them with quick a match to their needs. And then they basically engage. The things that we actually force here is that the negotiation is done in a US dollar equivalent. I saw so many CEOs and startups doing mistake, negotiating help with promising 0.5% here or 1% here, 2% here. And as investors that I've done over the last 10 years, we have to clean it up later. So we force people to actually negotiate in the US dollar equivalent. And we, in our system, we limit them not to exceed what the board approved. So if it was $250,000, we make sure that whenever they negotiate, to not to exceed this number. And they can negotiate, and they have like three ways to engage with expert. It can be like a retainer, find somebody to help me. It can be $1,000, $2,000 a month retainer equivalent, or a specific task. Let's say it's $10,000 for ABCD, or even by the hour. Let's say there is a lot of developers that are willing to help their friends doing their startup. They know that they're worth like $70 an hour, $100 an hour to work on the next release. And basically, they do the work here, and we track everything, and later on, they'll get the future equity. I'll do it very fast. When the task is completed, startup approved, and basically, the expert receive here an option for a future share in the company. Let's say, just to make sure how it works, let's say a year later, there is a qualified round, a VC invests $5 million in the company. We basically build a structure with the best lawyers in the world here, Wilson Sonsini in the US, Shenhav in Israel, and EY was actually validating the model. And we create the structure that the expert, whatever they put in dollar, equivalent to dollar until the round, they basically get equity or options in the company in the same valuation that the VC basically invests in the company. Just instead of investing cash, they basically investing their work. They get options, they don't get share. And we put some restriction here on the option. I will not get into too much details because I'm out of time. But the most important thing is to make sure that the experts are not taxed when they get it, but only when there is an exit or when they see cash. So we put some limitation and restriction on the option to make it happen. And this is basically the way it works. The qualified round basically close the pool, and if the company want, they can open another pool towards the next round. This is basically a summary of the value proposition. We basically have a quality pool of experts. The experts are basically, we have more and more every day. These are talents that you cannot find anywhere else. I mean, some of the experts here are willing to work only for an upside. They know the risk of downside of equity. They know the upside. Some of them will not work for cash. We made the engagement very easy. All the option, all electronically signed. All the experts know the rules of the game, so you don't need to convince them about equity. They know the downside, they know the upside. We're basically extending the startup runway by allowing them having more pool to make more goals towards the next round. And we make all the legal simple. What we do basically, we now worked 3 months in Israel already. We have 30 startups, 1,000 experts, already transactioning. A transaction happened in place. So we're looking for more promising startup. If you know, let them know about us. We're looking for more experts. Right now, we basically start the beta in Israel, but on May, we're gonna launch in the US and then Europe. This is it, Equity X Make, equity compensation, fair, accurate, safe, and simple to use. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ran. Now please welcome Gal from NG.
We started NG really from a personal pain of going to the repair shop. And today we go to the mechanic frustrated and helpless. And it came from a real pain of me having an old car, a Mazda 2 from 2004 that gave me tons of trouble. I felt like the only thing I did with it was to go to the mechanic. And every time I didn't know how much I was going to pay and what needed to be fixed. But then I realized I wasn't alone, because actually 66% of drivers feel helpless when they go to the repair shop. So it's not only a problem that I have, Gal, or as a woman, but actually all others have as well. because this market has no transparency whatsoever. Only one side has all the information and all the data, which is the mechanics, and drivers are just clueless. And this is where we understood there's a huge market waiting to be disrupted. And that's why we got to NG, which is actually the first end-to-end marketplace between drivers and mechanics, where drivers know all the information about their vehicle's health, and then, in case of a malfunction or a car fault, they get real-time quotes from nearby mechanics. So then they know how much they're going to pay before they get to the mechanic, not like what happened to me. So let's see how it looks. So you connect to the car computer, you're probably asking yourself, with a small Bluetooth device. It's a standard device that can be connected to every car from 2002. Very easy and simple under the dashboard. And then once it's connected, you get all the information about your car. And just like you can see here, in a very simple and easy way to understand that both me and my grandmother will be able to know what's going on, you can see what the problem is, and the best part, get the real-time quotes from mechanic. And this is super important, because before you go to the mechanic, you already know how the quality of the service is going to be like and how much you're going to pay. And we see that there's a difference about between 35 to 40% by just comparing prices between the mechanics. So this is huge. Now, another part of NG is the real-time data. And we see that drivers are using NG constantly to know about fuel consumption and battery charge. And this is because we get all this information and gather so much data about the speed, the RPM, the acceleration. And we do, after that, big data analysis. So the business model, you're probably asking yourself, is that we charge for the affiliation fee for the mechanics, and about 10% from each transaction. So if we're talking about repair maintenance, it's about $30, but for body parts, that's huge. It's about $200 for every transaction. So this is already working and running in Israel. We have about 100,000 users connected to NG, and they use it about 6-7 times a month. So they constantly get the information, and they come and use it back. The retention is about 46%, and this means that they come and use back NG after 3 months. Just so you know, the average is about 30-35%. On the mechanic side, then, we're working with over 300 mechanics all over Israel. And just like I said, there's a huge saving for the drivers. So next time you go to the mechanic, go with NG. And coming up, we already have a few thousand users in the UK and the US, but we're going to have a massive launch in the UK in the upcoming months. So if anyone's here from London, come look for us. I have one. March 15th, and we're going up. So it's really exciting, and we're going to go massive in the UK. And in Israel, we're just going to add more and more services. So towing, insurance, everything you need to know for your car maintenance, you're going to be able to find through NG. Did I miss anything? No. So we did an investment with OurCrowd and other VCs, leading VCs from Israel and the US about a half year ago. And we're not currently in the funding round, but like every startup, we're constantly raising money. So beware. Just a note about the auto industry. The auto industry is going to go huge in the next few years. And you can see here just a few companies that raised times 10 from NG, and they're disrupting each market, if it's an insurance or the car sales or the autonomous cars. But NG is the only one that's focusing on this old market of repair and maintenance, and it's a huge one. So it's going to explode in the next few years. This was us. If you have any questions, I'll be here or at the booth. I'm happy to answer. Thank you.